Hi there. Good afternoon, I guess. Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Boone Foster, the Associate Dean for Diversity, Education, and Research, and I'm just so happy to see everyone here in celebration of seven dynamic women who have contributed much to the mission and legacy of diversity that defines SUNY Downstate. So in celebration of National Women's History Month, the Office of Diversity and Inclusion, thank you, Mr. Antoine, the Office of Diversity, Education, and Research are proud to honor seven dynamic women at Downstate for their contribution to promoting diversity and inclusion. And these contributions are sometimes small, but when taken together, make a collective huge impact on who we are and what we do. These are women who promote diversity and inclusion in their walks, in their talks, and in just answering the telephone in more activities such as mentorship and teaching. And I'm particularly proud that the first annual Dale Blackstock Award for Excellence in Service is being given today in honor of a woman who really touched my life. She's a physician, advocate, and mentor, and she left a permanent and indelible mark in me as a student when I was a student here, and even after I graduated from SUNY Downstate. So thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule to celebrate with your friends, your colleagues, and family members. And I would like to give a special thanks to Dr. Daniels Asaze. Woohoo! So Dr. Daniels Asaze and Ms. Shondell Goldsmith really worked hard to put this together. We change rooms, we change time, and but I think it's going to be a beautiful event, so thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Boone Foster. Welcome, everyone. So glad to have all of you here. I am looking forward to honoring these wonderful women and also hearing the dynamic lecture from our keynote today. This is something that we've been thinking about doing for several years through our office because we feel that there are unsung heroines that have not been honored for all of the work that they've done, specifically in diversity and service. These are people that we can call on at a minute's notice and say we need help with a summer program, pipeline programs, initiatives throughout the institution for all five colleges and the hospital, and they are ready to do whatever is asked of them. So we thought that this would be the perfect time to honor these wonderful women and let them know how much we appreciate the work that they've done and how important they are to this institution. It helps to have women who have embodied the mission of Downstate, and that's why we wanted to continue to have something like this and honor them for all the work that's being done. And this will be an annual event. So we look forward to doing this in the name of Dr. Dale Blackstock, someone who worked very hard here as a faculty person and clinician. So, and we're happy to have her daughters here to talk to you about her in a few moments. But before we get started on the award ceremony, I'd like to start with our keynote speaker. So it is my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Pamela Strocker, who is the Director of Operations for the Brooklyn Health Disparities Center. Dr. Strocker works in the Department of Medicine and the College of Medicine at SUNY Downstate as a research assistant professor in addition to her role as the Director of Operations for the BHDC. Dr. Strocker has been responsible for maintaining linkages and collaboration with the center's program advisory board and the center's executive leadership. In her role with the BHDC, she has worked to strengthen the integration of the cores and has worked on the recruitment of other SUNY Downstate researchers and has assured the center's dissemination of information. Very important to the center's success has been her work in expanding the center's collaboration with researchers and departments outside the center. As a psychologist, she has provided training in the areas of mental health, leadership, wellness, and health disparities. Dr. Strocker is a licensed psychologist, life business coach, and author of the book, Let Me Stop You Right There, and 28 Lines Every CEO, Manager, and Supervisor Should Know. With more than 25 years of experience as a mental health and management professional, Dr. Strocker serves individuals and organizations who want to establish productive environments for peak performance. She provides solutions and strategies that build a spirit of collaboration, respect, and mutual benefit. Dr. Strocker owns private practices providing biofeedback and counseling services to victims of vehicular and employment accidents. She has provided evaluation, coaching, and psychotherapeutic services for a wide range of publications. So at this point, I would like to introduce to you Dr. Pamela Strocker.
Oh, thank you so much. Okay, I made the mistake of giving Doc all of that information, and we really only needed this much. So I thank you so much for honoring me. And I want to just share with everyone here that my friends in the diversity office kind of hoodwinked me. They said, oh, we just need you to talk for 10 minutes. But this is such an honor, and I just want to say, Dr. Booten Foster and Dr. Daniels, that I am honored that you all asked me to do this on this first annual event. I was asked to talk about leadership, and so, you know, they said 10 minutes, you know, this, that, and the other. It's a good thing I did a little prep, just, you know, because I would have just had a conversation with you, and I hope it will be sort of more like that. There's a lot going on up here, so hopefully we can get through this together. So the first thing I wanted to talk about, or to really ask the audience, is what do you see as leadership? First of all, I don't do talks to people, I talk with people, so I need responses. So, what is leadership? Can anybody tell me?
Listening.
Okay, listening, what else?
Vision,
having vision. Structure, that's a good one.
Motivation.
What? Somebody in the back?
Empathy.
All of those are part of leadership. And what makes leadership different from just management? Does anybody have an idea? Yes.
Management is getting things done. Okay.
Okay, said by one of our great leaders in the nursing department. Anybody else? Okay, so from my perspective, and again, today I'm speaking a lot from my perspective and the experiences I've had in that long list they read me. Leadership is really about inspiring others to join with you in working toward this mission. It is also about bringing others into leadership role so that you do not feel that you are taking control, number one, and leading everyone without their consent. So I'm hoping that I can keep up with the slides even. What are some of the challenges of leadership? And we've got many leaders here, so you all should be able to tell me.
Limited resources.
What else? Yes.
Politics.
Oh, boy.
Sexism,
okay. Anything else? Okay, well, you know, when I was asked to talk about this, I really thought in terms of what we have recently been through. And I have a boss who does not like us to go too deeply into this. But I will say that I woke up the day after the election, and I knew that I had to really embrace what I'm going to talk about today. So for me, We're leading, but we have to be able to embrace change. So leaders are people who are able to help us all embrace the changes that we're about to go through. So I must share with you that the morning after our election, I spoke to Dr. Bootenfoss. I was reeling. I couldn't quite get my footing. And I literally had to go deep to embrace the change that we here in healthcare and in the country were about to go through. but the biggest, one of the biggest challenges is really about embracing diversity, right? Or dealing with diversity. And what do I mean by diversity? I'm from the Brooklyn Health Disparity Center, so you have some expectations about what I'm going to talk about, but I'm not. But what does diversity mean? Tell me what that means. All right, you haven't had lunch. You all are failing me. Okay. Absolutely. So when we talk about diversity, we talk about all of these different areas, right? And it's this big puzzle that we have to put together, and we've got to deal with it in our workspace, right? All of these, and I'm sure we could come up with more that constitute diversity in the workplace. I myself am going to focus on age. The issue of age, and I'm not going to share with you my age, but there's going to be a document coming around, and I want you to take a look at it, and I want you to look at some of the attributes that are listed on these sheets of paper, and find yourself. So they're going to be core values, they're going to be attributes. I want you to look at those, and we're only going to spend a minute and a half on this. Find yourself on this piece of paper. You know, the Brooklyn Health Disparity Center spends a lot of time doing research, so you know, we always have surveys, we've got this, we've got that. Hopefully this one will be short and sweet and to the point. I'm not collecting any data. Now, on the sheet of paper, there are all these attributes, and they all are associated with certain generations. How many of us know what generation in which we would fit?
Yes.
I'm Gen X.
You're a Gen X. Okay. And what makes you a Gen X?
Pardon?
What makes you a Gen X?
So my understanding is that Gen X were the children of the baby boomers, and so I was a young person in the 80s, and I think that there's actually a demographic, like a number in terms of years, and I fit right in that.
Okay, does anybody else?
I identify also with the Gen X, like we were slackers when we graduated from... No, remember the slacker term? That was my generation.
I'm right there with you.
I don't do terms. Anybody else know what they are? Yes.
I'm a millennial.
You're a millennial. What makes you a millennial?
I came of age in an era marked by a financial crisis caused by a generation before us who then...
You're a baby boomer. Well, you've named several of the categories in which we find ourselves. And usually, we talk about these four categories. Millennials, Gen Xs,
baby boomers, and traditionalists. I will not tell you which one I fit into. I'm safe somewhat because I am on the board, but you know. What I want to say about this is that this makes for a very complicated mix in terms of what we're dealing with in the workplace, because guess what? All four of those categories are in the workplace. All four of them. And if you are going to lead, you're really going to have to be talking to all four of these generations. And guess what? You've got an additional one, the Gen Zs. Okay, so they were born between 1994 and 2010. And guess what? They're coming to get us. So essentially, there are five groups of people we are dealing with in the workplace. And I just want to, you know, I am going to share this with you. So I was very lucky. I was looking for someone to help with the work in Brooklyn Health Disparity Center. And this beautiful young woman came and said, Dr. Straker, I applied. And she said, no. She said, I'd like to work with you. And I said, could you give me your resume? I already applied. So I then went through this file of resumes I had, obviously needing help. And there was the resume. And that's Lakia. Here's what's shocking about working with Lakia. I'm going to give it up. But I could be Lakia's grandmother. Okay? So what I'm trying to show you is what we're dealing with just in terms of the diversity of age that we are now dealing with in the workplace. I'm going to go back a couple of slides just so you all can see where you found your categories or your attributes, right? So for those of you who like to adhere to rules, you're in the traditionalist bag. Baby boomers are anti-war and that whole list in the second column. Generation X, they like balance and they're in the third column. And millennials are into achievement and they're in the fourth column. So if you look at those columns on your sheet of paper, those are supposed to be the categories in which we find ourselves, right? So traditionalists, baby boomers, Generation X, millennials, and then I just told you about Gen Zs. There's something very interesting about this. I went through this list and really tried to figure out where I fit. And I was shocked because basically I have attributes in every single one of these. And when I sat to think about that, I'm very lucky. Because it means then I could still work. At the moment that you stop having some variety of all of these, it's time to hang it up. And that is when I will come to whomever and I will say, it is time for me to leave. Okay? So just know that these attributes that I've shared with you, we should have some in every category. Okay? Anybody have thoughts about that, or does that make sense to you?
Yes.
Okay, and let me tell you how I know that, you know, the time will be within the next however many years. So, I don't do public transportation. I never did, really. I always drove, right? But now we're at a point where I don't even want to drive. So I'm saying to myself, self, you're going to have to start thinking about this. This is the first time I have ever worked within 10 minutes of my home, just so you know. I've worked in other states, in other places, this, that, and the other. But you have to start really understanding who you are in the workspace and in the surrounding area so that you can know when it's going to be your time to hang it up. If I were wealthy enough, I'd be chauffeured to work every day. I'm not, so, okay. All right, so there are benefits to being
in a multi-generational environment, right? So with a multi-generational team, these are the benefits. We can attract and retain talented people of all ages. The team is more flexible. We can gain and maintain market share. And let me tell you something about Downstate. Downstate does so much with so little. I have to tell you, a lot of it is because there are people who are attracted to the mission of Downstate. And this has been the case since I was a child. And as a developing professional, Downstate was and now continues to be on the cutting edge in terms of dealing with some issues that other hospitals don't deal with. So I threw that in because we do, you know, we've got our market share, okay? We've got people moving into Brooklyn, they're going to take over all the patients and whatnot, but at the end of the day, they have to understand this patient population. Okay, decisions are stronger because they're broad-based with multiple perspectives. The team is more innovative and creative, and the team can meet the needs of a diverse public and can relate more effectively. This is the type of leadership model that most people adhere to. Do you think this works for a diverse environment? Why doesn't it work? Come on, out loud. Say that. They're all men. Well, that's what else?
People have capacities beyond the little slot on the organization chart.
Yeah. Okay. What else? This poor person at the top, they are in deep trouble. So right now, Dr. Lucchese would be the one that would be like, OMG. I get no feedback in any direction. Everything is going from me down. This is a killer. It's a killer not only for the leader, but for everybody along those lines, because there are no lines that are going in between, et cetera, et cetera. So I just want to point out that when we think about leadership, and even management, a lot of times we think about this. And we do think about all men. Even though I must share with you, I didn't even think about that. But we always think about this top-down leadership. Let me just show you what some of the more innovative companies are doing to embrace change. They're doing this. All right? So these companies include Amazon, Google, Facebook, Microsoft, Apple, and Oracle. Okay? What are these pictures showing us? Say it again.
An interconnected system.
Okay, it's an interconnected system. What about it? What else about it?
No stagnant
stuff going on here. I think that really what they're all trying to show you is that at some point, even if you are I'm going to call you the person in charge, even if you're that person in charge, there are going to be people who are in your organization who leave, right? So you ask me to make up a chart. Am I more competent at that than other people? And why would I think that I should design how the chart should be, et cetera, et cetera? You have to learn from everybody else. And I have to share with you that I've been really feeling very good about our office upstairs, which is hidden away, and I'm so thankful. But when I have Lakia and several young people who work in the front portion of the office, and about, I would say, once a month or so, I go out there to get my cup of coffee, and then we get to talk
And, you know, I get to hear what they're saying about things. And it is so important to have that perspective as you go forward. You cannot move a program or embrace all people if you do not hear and listen to what they're saying and try to, wherever possible, it's not always possible, but try to embrace their technique. That's number one. Number two is, it changes your mind about things. Yeah. I was kind of scared before the election because I said, ooh, this is what people are really feeling. And I had no clue because, of course, I'm from New York, I'm from Brooklyn, I'm from here, and I just knew we were not going to have to deal with this change. But we've got to deal with this change. And part of dealing with it is embracing all these different designs, okay? Understanding that we move in and out of being the leader depending on whatever we're dealing with, okay? Okay, this is too small to read. However, since you all said 10 minutes, I did not want to have 1,000 slides. The most important things on this for me are that leaders should listen, they should consult others, communicate proactively, seek and introduce change, accept new ideas and support change initiatives. So from my perspective, from where I sit, being able to embrace change is one of the most important things that you could do or develop within yourself. In this little book I wrote, which really was about a change going on in my life, one of the stories I talk about is the person who says to you, we never did it this way. We always used to do. How many people have met that person? All right.
At Downstate or elsewhere?
It doesn't matter. Anywhere. Run for your life when you meet that person. Because if you cannot change or roll with it, you're going to be in trouble, period. And figure out your strategy for whatever it is you're going to do given the change. So in my office, for instance, we talked about, what went on, and I tried to get myself together that day. And one of the things I committed to was making certain that all of the students that go through our programs get some kind of idea about civics. Because we don't know what we're doing. That's essentially what it's about. People do not understand civics, and that's part of how we wound up where we Okay, so I'm going to say thank you. I wanted to point out one other thing. Even in terms of our personal lives, I heard Dr. Allen speak. I literally heard one sentence of what he was talking about as I was leaving the room. And he was talking about how he's younger than me, but when I was younger, we kind of all lived in our communities, right? So I would have lived on Quincy Street in Brooklyn when I was very young. And we had a community. We were listening. We were talking to one another. We were having dinner with our families. How many of us are doing that now? How many are listening to what our children are saying and what our parents are saying and what our grandparents are saying and integrating that information so that we can make it work? I didn't have a lot of time today, but if I can just get across one point, it is so important for us to embrace some of what used to be and bringing it into what is now. Right? So my nieces, they don't write letters. They text. And I had to embrace it. I have friends who refuse to move to that next step. I don't know how to do it. You're getting tired. It's time for you all to start it's going to move beyond us all. All right? And when it moves beyond us all, we will be in there holding it back, holding everybody back, and that's not what we want to be about. Any questions before I say thank you? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Straker. We really appreciate you. Don't forget the chocolate.
Yes, she's feeding me chocolate.
I heard that was her favorite from a little birdie, so I wanted to make sure she had some. At this time, I would like to invite the daughters of Dr. Dale Blackstock to the podium. We would like them to just give us a little history of who their mother was, and even frame it in a way so that we would know why we're honoring her today. We're not going to read the bio, so you have your bios in your program just so you can see the rich life that she lived. But we wanted more of a personal touch by bringing the daughters up. So if Uche and Oni can join us. And the great thing is that this is a very small world. I actually grew up with them, and we went to the same middle school right here in Brooklyn at St. Mark's Day School. So it's really great to be able to have them here and to also have them just part of this experience, because we've always talked about honoring somebody who is important to us, but to actually have them here to talk about her.
Thank you all for having us here. And I'd like to thank in particular Dr. Bhutan Foster and Dr. Daniel Zasaze for creating this lecture and luncheon, which will hopefully be done annually in honor of our mother. When Dr. Daniels emailed us about the event, I think it's safe to say both Oni and I were overwhelmed. Our mother was a very, very special person, and we miss her terribly. Her absence, in this world, I mean, doesn't just affect us. It affects the people that she worked with, the patients that she took care of, her entire community. The fact that she's not here with us is really just a profound, profound loss. And I think that I'm hoping that this luncheon and awards ceremony will help folks, learn about her and learn about who she was and how she contributed to SUNY Downstate, and beyond. When I think of our mother, I think of, the words that come to mind are determination, ambition, resiliency. She was, as I said, very special, and she couldn't have done everything that she did without the help and support of those around her. She was one of six siblings born to a single mother here in Brooklyn. She was raised on public assistance. Really, the odds were always against her. But she always had a love for science, for her studies. She was always very committed to her studies. And along the way, she was fortunate to find people who saw that interest and were able to support her and encourage her along the way. And I think it's because of that that our mom gave back so much when she, became a physician and wanted to come back and work in the community in which she was raised. So I think that's why, I think about why diversity is important and inclusion is important. That's why, because you need people who understand the community, who understand the needs of the community, who the patients can relate to, I think are probably sort of most effective providers. Do you
want to say anything? Yeah, no, I think Uche has spoken to this, and would have said the same thing that she said. And I think also just to highlight, I think a lot of times we think we're the only ones who think about our mom. And so getting that email from Dr. Osaze and hearing that Dr. Bhutan Foster wanted to start this luncheon and awards ceremony, and hopefully this will be a tradition, it made us realize that our lives weren't the only lives that she had touched, and that she is still remembered. And so I think that is probably one of the most meaningful parts of today. And also just to mention, our mom was born in Brooklyn. She's a Brooklyn girl. She only went away for 4 years to Boston to go to Harvard Med School, and she came right back. And so this is where she lived. This is her stomping grounds. My sister and I basically grew up at this hospital. Our dad would bring us here a lot when my mom was on call.
I did my emergency medicine residency here. And one of the reasons, other than just being a great training program, is I wanted to be closer to my mom's spirit, and I know for some people that may sound a little hokey, but really, she made such an impact here that I wanted to work in this community because I knew it was important to her as well. So she has touched so many hearts, and I'm so glad that we have the opportunity today to share with you just a little bit about who she was. I wish all of you had the opportunity to meet her. She was a really dynamic woman, very much ahead of her times. And I think if she knew this was happening, she would be overwhelmed and very, very grateful.
Thank you. Oh, what did we do?
Wanted to make sure that we honored you as well, because
you
are the legacy of Dr. Blackstock. We wanted to make sure that we honored them as well, so let them know how much we care about them and we welcome them here. So thank you. At this time, I'd like to ask Dr. Booten Foster to come to the podium to present our first Dr. Dale Blackstock Award recipient.
So I am honored to present the first Dr. Daniel Hill Williams, Dr. Dale Blackstock Award to Dr. Teresa Smith. And, you know, as Dr. Daniel Zasazi and I were thinking about who should be the recipient of this award, we went through a short list of names. You know, when I first met Dr. Blackstock, I was in awe of her, and I was afraid of her, because she always made sure that as a young physician, a medical student of color, that I did above what I was required to do, which meant not coming on time, but early. And if I was early, she'd say, "I was waiting for you." I'm like, "But we're supposed to be here at 11 o'clock, but I was waiting for you at 10:45 to go over what you would present." She was attentive to detail. She cared. She went above and beyond, really, what her job was. So when we started thinking about, you know, there's so many wonderful, wonderful, wonderful faculty here, but one of the first faculty members who actually I reached out to before I came here, and she responded. And she said, "Well, this is what you have to do, this is who you have to meet, and we should meet." And she made me feel welcome. So when I came here, I felt like I was at home, and that's what Dr. Blackstock does. You know, wherever you met her, she would take you to her home, she would take you to the opera, and she made you feel like you were at home. And so thank you so much, Dr. Smith, for welcoming me and countless others, faculty and students, your guidance, your attention, your ability to listen is what makes you and contribute to the diversity of this institution. So thank you very much and congratulations.
Thank you.
So our next series of awards were called the Diversity Champions Awards. And these are individuals who have assisted not just our office, but assisted in providing diversity throughout all of SUNY Downstate's institution. So we wanted to make sure that we recognize the work that they've done and to let them know that we appreciate them and that they are truly honored today. So our first recipient is Dr. Daisy Cruz Richmond.
Hi, good morning. I am truly honored for receiving this award. I would like to share this award with the College of Nursing faculty, staff, and students. The College of Nursing celebrated its 50th anniversary last year. Throughout our rich history, we take pride in our tradition of educating qualified nurses from all diverse backgrounds. And currently, we have 47% underrepresented students in the College of Nursing compared to only 12% nationwide. So I really thank the College of Nursing faculty, staff, and students in their commitment to diversity and inclusion. And I take pride that Uchi and Oni are here. They are the godchildren of my husband.
I
You know, we all have people that are behind us. I didn't get here by myself, right? And so I have to thank my parents, especially my mother, who supported me along the way, and the very many mentors, who most of which were actually not my same gender or my same race or come from the same cultural experience as I did. But they did push me here and tell me that I can do it. But then I met Uche. And, you know, I met Uche where I trained. And she was like a unicorn to me. I had not actually had a mentor who was an African-American woman. So she definitely was a unicorn. And she, you know, I did not have the pleasure of meeting her mother. But I can say that she must have been a wonderful woman to raise two wonderful women. And so for that, you know, I thank you for this honor. And the days that I want to give up, because it's a very difficult job, I think that I must be a unicorn for someone. And so, you know, that's why I keep doing this work. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Smith. And now we have Anne Marie Cullen from the Office of Faculty Affairs and Professional Development. This time I'd like to call Dr. Magda Aliansen to the podium to present our next award.
I just wanted to say a few words before I handed out this award. This award is being presented to Ms. Lotus Jones, the Assistant Director of the Office of Academic Development. I have worked with Lotus for over 10 years now. I'm going on my 11th year. I'm very proud of that. Lotus has conducted the academic skills component of the early medical education program, as well as the Exploring Health Careers program for our pipeline programs in our Office of Diversity Education and Research. She has supported a lot of our initiatives and contributed tirelessly to working with diverse populations. I personally want to thank you, Lotus, for your encouragement, your support, and everything that you have done for our programs and our students. So it is my honor to present you with the Diversity Champions Award to Ms. Lotus Jones.
Okay, I want to thank the office for this award. It's quite surprising. I'm used to working in the shadows. I come in sometimes very strange hours, and I leave very strange hours. And for that, I have my husband to thank, because he's always willing to pick me up at a moment's notice. I live way out in Queens, you know, but he can take the Jackie Robinson and be here in a half an hour. I started here in the June of 2003, and that same month, I was in the saddle working for the Early Medical Education Program and the Exploring Health Career. So I started out with a bang. And the summertime has always been one of my favorite times because it's very busy. And I get to meet a lot of students. And like in the bio, I said I'm retiring in, you know, next year. And it's not because I feel like I don't have any of these attributes anymore. It's just that as someone said, I'm not retiring, I'm rewiring. So I have a lot of other things that I want to do with my life, you know, while the elevator is still going to the top. Once again, I thank you for this award.
Okay. Before I go to the next award, this was happening so fast. I was just surprised to know that Dr. Smith actually knew Dr. Blackstock and Dr. Deja Cruiser-Smith's husband was their godfather. I was like, it was a 6 degrees of separation. And Anne Marie Cullen was come back up here, Anne Marie. Just come back up here. Come on. Quickly. Just come back up here. Okay. So if you're going to blame anyone for me being here, I just came back to my alma mater in May. So you have to blame this woman. Because she's the one who was, she said, you know what, the committee would like to interview you. So I said, okay, well, how do we do this? Because I really don't want my job to know that I'm even applying to someplace else. And if I don't get the job, I don't want them to know. She's like, don't worry, we got this. And she said, and then, you know, as the interviews continued, she was like, you know, she really made me feel, again, welcome before I even got here. So blame her.
And Dr. Molina also. But thank you so much.
I'm so glad you said I didn't have to say anything, so I didn't prepare anything. I just wanted to thank everybody here at Downstate. It is truly a wonderful job that I have. I love working in faculty affairs, and I've met so many different people and had so many different experiences in the last 6 years, and I really appreciate it. Thank you for the award.
So our next recipient for the Diversity Champions Award goes to Ms. Betty Jung. So this is the person who really embodies the spirit of community service. She has worked with countless hours with several students, our free clinic, colon cancer screening, our patient advisory committee, and she really helps us to open our doors. So what our impact is beyond the academic institution, but to the community also. And that also is part of the spirit of diversity, recognizing that if we are to become, if we are a premier academic institution, but we need the help and input from the community. And thanks to Ms. Jung, we open our doors to hearing community voices from all walks of life. So thank you for embodying the spirit and championing the cause for diversity at SUNY Downstate.
I actually have to thank everyone here. I didn't get here by myself either. I've been here a long, long time. I've worked with so many different services to help provide support. As Dr. Straker has mentioned, the challenges we face, it certainly is manpower. But you know, with the help of Department of Nursing, College of Medicine, institutional advancement. Michael Harrell has been a big part of it, so was Ellen Watson. There's just so many people to thank. So I really thank all of you for all the support. Don't forget the students. I can't do it without them either. From the College of Nursing to the College of Medicine to the Public Health School of Public Health and other CHIRP students. So thank you all.
Now, our next award recipient is someone who had a tall order to fill for a short period of time where she served as interim dean for the College of Health-Related Professions. But in that capacity, she also helped our office run one of our pipeline programs, the Exploring Health Careers program, which took a lot of work to organize all of the faculty in the department and to help us provide activities and academic preparation for students from undergraduate schools in the area. So at this time, I'd like to bring to the podium Dr. Margaret Kaplan.
I would like to remind, I'm a baby boomer, and we carried signs, we don't like government, we like causes. As I told the students many times, that's a problem. You're telling me about a problem. Give me a sign, I'll write the sign for you. We will march around the campus and publicize your problem. And they're like, whoa, who is this person? But that's what we used to do. So I would just like to remind all the younger people here that it wasn't that long ago that no one could vote except white male landowners. So no one had anything in this country, and it was not that long ago. And we've come a long way, obviously, but we have a long way to go. And I am a descendant of Susan B. Anthony. So in my genetics, in my epigenetics, my mother made sure that none of her children could ever miss a voting day, ever. My sisters and I looked at each other a few years ago and said, "Do you ever miss a voting day?" Never, never, I can't, Mom would kill me. I think people don't always remember what things used to be like. Mm-hmm. When I was in college, we were not allowed to vote until 21. So things have changed, and one of our big things was you can draft us, but we can't vote. not fair. So find me the not fair things. We love them, baby boomers. So, and thank you all, Downstate.
Last but not least, we created a special award for someone that we know works very hard here, continues to have a smile on her face every time someone walks in, is always available when you ask for help, and always just pleasant to work with. And a lot of times we walk past people and don't say hello when we see them working. And that frustrates me, because I know these are people who work really hard that should always be honored, no matter where they are, what they're doing, in the capacity of the work that they're doing. So we created what's called the Outstanding Service Award, and this year we'd like to present it to Ms. Margaret Johnson from Facilities Management.
Thank you all very, very much. It is indeed an honor and a privilege to receive such an outstanding award, and I thank God for being here also to receive it. From the bottom of my heart, I do thank you all very, very much.
Congratulations to all of our award winners. Everything well deserved. Keep up the good work. We look forward to doing this again next year and honoring a new set of women who have been outstanding here at the institution. At this time, I'd like to call Mr. Kevin Antoine up for closing remarks.
I'm going to ask Dr. Lucchesi to give a few words before I do.
Thank you, thank you, and thank you, Kevin. It's a great day. It really is. I'm very proud of all the recipients. I'm really glad everybody put this together. It really is what we stand for at Downstate, no matter what, no matter how difficult it is. You people make this a great place to work, so thank you very much. Thank you.
Everybody enjoy the program?
Yes.
Wasn't it good? Didn't it feel good to be honored on things that you care about? I want to thank the Office of Diversity, Education, and Research for having the wisdom and the vision to establish this more than appropriate function during Women's History Month. As you know, the national theme with the National Women's Center is honoring women who are trailblazers in both labor and business. And I think we can add now healthcare to that, because we did honor a true trailblazer at Downstate Medical Center and in the area of healthcare and medicine. We've heard all the good things that we can do in diversity. We've had a great lecture by the keynote speaker of all the categories that make up what is diversity and how it engages us in our workplace. But what I want you to take from here is that when you leave from here, the work has to continue. Where we're up in public, diversity is a nice thing to say. Sounds good. Everybody likes it. But I think, as Dr. Foster would tell you, it's some hard work. You got to roll up your sleeve, and you got to stay the course. That's the most important thing. You got to stay the course. So here at Downstate, we have learned to embrace a lot of different changes, some for the good, some for the not so good. But one of the things that I always remember growing up, and I grew up in Mississippi, it doesn't matter who's in front of you. It's what you do to keep pushing ahead. So it doesn't matter who's the new president of the United States or the new incoming administration here at Downstate. We got to keep pushing ahead, because that's not going to change what we do between 9 to 5. And so I want to, thank everyone for coming out. I want to thank the Office of Diversity and Research for inviting us to collaborate with this. But remember, the work about diversity is staying the course. So let's stay the course. Thank you.